One, two, 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 two. The mountain of God, who may stand in the holy place, the clean of hand and pure of heart, who may approach your throne of grace, purify me, O Lord. Take these hands and take this heart. Take my life and make it yours. Purify me, O Lord, that I may go up the mountain of God, that I may stand in the holy place. Take these hands and take this heart. Lord, I long to see your face. Purify me, O Lord. Take these hands and take this heart. Take my life and make it yours. Purify me, O Lord. Purify me, O Lord. Take these hands and take this heart. Take my life and make it yours. Purify me, O Lord.
Okay, it works. Okay, good. Well, people are starting to make their way in. We have got a lot to cover tonight, so let's go ahead and begin with a prayer. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Come, Holy Spirit, fill the hearts of your faithful, and kindle in them the fire of your love. Send forth your Spirit, and they shall be created, and you shall renew the face of the earth. O Lord, instruct the hearts of the faithful by the light of the Holy Spirit. Give us the same Spirit, that we may be truly wise, and ever rejoice in his consolation through Christ our Lord. Amen. St. Joseph, pray for us. St. Alice, pray for us. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Well, good. Well, tonight, I'm very excited to talk with you about the Psalms. It's kind of a break from what we've been doing. We've been covering a lot of historical material all throughout this course, and the Book of Psalms is really different in its theme. It's a different kind of genre of sacred literature. It's sacred poetry. And the Psalms really could be considered a synthesis of all of salvation history. So everything that we've covered thus far and everything we will cover is in the Psalms. So if you find that you can't remember things, the Psalms are kind of to try to keep the memory alive of all the stories we have been hearing thus far. So that's why we pray them often, because they call to mind and they echo back these stories we've already read and studied. Psalms are part of wisdom literature, so we've been studying kind of historical books, and now we're moving into to wisdom books, okay? So they're going to talk about what it is to be truly wise and how to really apply divine wisdom to your life. So the Psalms are designed to be sung or prayed aloud. So when I was singing a little bit earlier this morning, that was based on one of the Psalms: who can go up the mountain of God, who can stand in the holy place, the man with clean of hand and pure of heart, right? So that was a song that was written by Dan Bartelson. He's a great musician. He's out in Montana. So thank him for that song. It's very good. The word psalmos in Greek means song. So pretty simple. These are a book of songs. And psalterion is a stringed instrument. So a psaltery is a stringed instrument. It's like an ancient guitar. So that's it's appropriate. These psalms were designed to be prayed to music, and usually with a stringed instrument. And largely that's because, guess what instrument David played? He played a harp. So he's kind of biased toward the harp. So he played stringed instrument, and he made a lot of songs. Now, not all the psalms are written by King David. You'll notice as you were going through, some of them have headings like a song of Asaph, or a song of Korah, or the choir, etc. So we know very clearly that not all of them were written by David. Some of them are in the Babylonian exile after his death, right? So we see that very clearly. But he did write a lot of them, and he commissioned a lot of work, because what he did is he renewed liturgical worship. And before this time, there is no music in Hebrew worship. So David is the one who brings music into the church, as it were, right? So you can thank him for songs at Mass, okay? Because he's the one who actually brought singing. There's actually this whole debate about whether there should be music at all, right? So whether it should be silent, whether it should be chanted, or whether there should actually be instruments at all. There's a big argument about that, and that all goes back to this time right here with King David. Okay, now, religious worship, both Jewish and Catholic, very much uses the Psalms as our primary text for prayer. So at every Mass, we have a reading from the Psalms, don't we? We have a responsorial psalm that we sing. Also, priests and religious throughout the world pray the Psalms multiple times a day, 5 to 7 times a day, depending on what community you're a part of. And so the Psalms are very, very central to our life of worship, and so it's good that we look at it. What I've put up on here is one of Dr. Bergsma's great little tools to help us understand it. If you want a copy of Psalm Basics for Catholics, he actually goes into great detail with this, and it's a beautiful little book. We have a few copies on hand if you would like to purchase one. I'll be going through some of the things that are here. So this little chart will kind of guide us through tonight's class of kind of a basic structure for the Psalms. I'll explain what it means. Okay. So if we look at the Psalms, there are 150 of them. Okay, and they are in 5 collections or books. And they're roughly, I put it out on a timeline here, that basically you've got from 1 to 41 is book 1, 42 to 72 book 2, etc., moving down along the line. Now, each of these books has a basic theme to it. The first book is kind of represented by King Saul chasing David. So that's the spear guy, little king chasing him, right? So this little stick figure guy. The book 1 is really David as the suffering king. Now I want you to get it clear in your mind, the scheme that we're having here, it doesn't fit perfectly. There's going to be certain psalms that don't fit this match, but it's a general guideline that'll help us to understand it. So the first book is really kind of dominated by a lot of individual laments, okay? And a lament is a kind of psalm. So there's different kinds of psalms up here. I put different words. There's lament psalms, which are psalms that are crying out to God for help, right? There are thanksgiving psalms, giving thanks to God for his deliverance. There's hymns that are just generally praising God. There's curse psalms for your enemies. Yes, very good. And there's wisdom psalms to learn how to be truly wise. There's royal psalms which praise the king, David, and his descendants. And there's songs of Zion, so songs that are extolling the mountain where the temple is. So the mountain in Jerusalem, Mount Zion, right? Because this is the place where the temple's built. It's the place where God dwells. So those are all the kinds of basic psalms that you have throughout. And the first one, overwhelmingly, it's lamenting, because he's being chased and he's being oppressed. Okay, so it has joy in it also, but ultimately it's like, God, help me out here. I'm being oppressed, okay? Then you get to book 2, which is really the height of David's kingdom. He's now king, and he's handing on the baton to Solomon. So there's a lot more joy, whereas in the first book you might have had a quarter of the psalms that were joyful. Now it's like every other one, right? There's a lot more joy in this, a lot more extolling the praises of the king, extolling the praises of Zion, etc. So the glory of the kingdom, all these things, it's celebrating that, because this is the time where the kingdom is really doing well. Then you notice there's this precipitous slide, and we're ending up in the bottom of their unchained. So basically, this is the collapse of the kingdom in book 3, so a lot more communal laments, like we have sinned, and therefore we deserve what's happening to us, right? but also asking God for deliverance, right? So now book four, then you'll notice it's kind of like you've got sort of the pondering man over here, you know, asking the question why. Book four is kind of reflecting on how we got here. It's like, you might have wondered how I got here, right? You know, now we're doing a flashback, and we see we start actually this book four with a psalm from Moses. So the Davidic kingdom has collapsed, and we're like, okay, where do we go now? Let's go to somebody who knows something. The first psalm in this book, Psalm 90, is Moses, a song of Moses, talking about what would happen if you didn't obey God. So it's like, oh, that's why we're here, right? And there's a lot of psalms here. There's a little bit of joy in there, but ultimately we're in the Babylonian exile. And so this is the period of time for about 50, 60 years when the kingdom has collapsed and they are in exile and hoping for restoration. Then there's an abrupt shift in Psalm 106 toward the end of the book where we have now returned from exile and we're awaiting the restoration of the kingdom. You notice we're going up to the mountain, we're going up to Jerusalem, to the temple to worship God, but notice he doesn't have a crown. So the kingdom has not been restored yet. We're waiting for it in the future. And this points forward to the Messiah. Now, there's a lot of joyful psalms. There's also the Passover psalms, like when they go up to Jerusalem to offer Passover. They're called songs of ascent, because if you go to Jerusalem, how many have been to the Holy Land? Anybody been to the Holy Land? Okay. Jerusalem is up high, right? And so most people, when they're going to Jerusalem, they're walking up a hill. And so these are psalms that are designed when you're in pilgrimage, you're singing these songs together while you're on pilgrimage, going up the mountain of the Lord. Make sense? Okay, so that's a basic structure. There's some psalms that don't fit this neatly, but every book is kind of a collection of psalms that are roughly written in those time periods. So it's kind of written in the time when David is experiencing suffering in the kingdom, the collapse, et cetera, et cetera. So that's the basic structure. Okay, now let's talk briefly about what Hebrew poetry is like. So it's not Dr. Seuss, okay? There's not a lot of rhyming in Hebrew poetry, okay? You know, like every Dr. Seuss poem's got a lot of, you know, just fun rhymes, and I love rhyming poetry, but Hebrew doesn't typically do that in Hebrew poetry. Hebrew poetry, while it doesn't rhyme in its sound, it will rhyme in its ideas. So it's based on lines, which are called kola or colons. A line is a colon, and it's structured around two colons. So it's a bi-kola structure. So it's like it will have, you know, well, let's look at an example. It's easier to talk about, to show what it is. But there's two lines together. That's the most common. But the most rare is three lines together, and that's for special emphasis. And actually, the Psalms begin with a tri-kola. So if you open up the Psalms, let's look at Psalm 1. Okay. This is how the book of the Psalms begins. Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the wicked, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of scoffers. Right, so that's a tri-kola. It's three lines that have the same idea going on. And then it shifts, but, makes a contrast, but delights in the law of the Lord and meditates on it day and night. So it ends with a double line, which is, so it's a three line, you're like, you're disoriented, and now you're back to, boom, this is solid. So it's saying, this is a blessed man if you're not walking with the wicked, not standing with him, not sitting with him, right? But you delight in the law of the Lord and meditate on that law day and night. If you do that, he's like a tree planted beside streams of water that yields its fruit in its season. Its leaf does not wither, and all that he does, he prospers. The wicked are not so, but are like the chaff which the wind drives away. So you see how it's in twos? It's most of the time in twos. And you have things that are either the same idea or they're contrasted with each other. And that's kind of how Hebrew poetry is designed. Sometimes it will rhyme, but a lot of times it doesn't in the original language, just so you're aware of that. Okay. So if you're looking for a rhyming book, it doesn't do that. Okay. But there's beauty in it, and it's great, and it's structured in a very particular way. We could talk a lot more about that, but this is Bible basics, and I'm sure most of you didn't come here for a poetry lesson. Okay. Very good. All right. Now, the first two, now there's another theme we got to talk about, too, before we dive deeply, and that is the theme of the Todah. How many of you remember what that word is, Todah? Anybody? Okay. All right. A couple people. Todah means thanksgiving. Okay, and thanksgiving was a particular kind of sacrifice in Leviticus chapter 7. If you remember Leviticus, how many remember Leviticus? Nobody, of course. Yes, okay. So Leviticus chapter 7 talks about the instructions for when you're offering the Todah sacrifice, or as we would say in English, the sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. So a sacrifice of praise is actually a particular kind of sacrifice. What was that sacrifice like? It was a voluntary sacrifice. It means you didn't have to do it. Like if you sin, you have to offer a sin offering, right? For forgiveness of sins. The Todah is a completely free will offering. And why would you do it? Well, you do it because It was a promise you made to God, and there's basically what happens is you're in trouble. You cry out to God, and you say, hey, God, help me. If you help me out, I will offer a sacrifice of praise, right? And so then God delivers the person. They then go to the temple, offer the sacrifice of praise, and what's involved in that? You offer a sacrifice of bread. Interesting, right? And other things, and you throw a feast for all of those who come. And then you give public testimony to what God did for you. So it's an opportunity to give thanks to God publicly for the deliverance he gave you. Maybe you had cancer, maybe you had leprosy, maybe your enemies were attacking you, you were going to lose the farm, and God provided miraculously for you, and so you give thanks to God, he saved my life. And this is how he did it. Now, the Todah sacrifice had to be eaten that day. And so what this was an opportunity was is to say you tend to invite the poor and other people to make sure you ate all of the food. And so that's why poor people hung around the temple, because they were hoping for a meal, right? So they were hoping people would offer the Todah to then provide for the poor. So this was kind of a social justice thing as well, that it would provide for the hungry and the needy when people would offer their Thanksgiving sacrifice. Important. Okay. So we call this the Todah cycle, where a person begins to be in distress, I'm sick, they cry to God for help, they promise to offer the Todah, God delivers them, they make the sacrifice, they feast, and they give public testimony. Now, there are many psalms that have this cycle in them. Some that just have part of it, like crying out to God for help, or part of it giving thanks to God, right? Because these psalms, this whole book is actually designed for the Todah sacrifice. King David offered it a lot, and he actually principally offered the Todah sacrifice more than these other sacrifices. So the book of Psalms is actually designed for this particular offering. So that's why it has this structure. Now, there's a couple psalms that have the whole structure in it, one of them being Psalm 22. Remember Psalm 22? Let's turn with me to Psalm 22. See if you remember this. First line, my God, why have you forsaken me? Who said that? Jesus. Interesting. But you see, this psalm, we're going to go into it a little bit more, it has the whole cycle. It starts in distress, but then it gets to verse 19 and 21, where it says, don't be far off, God, listen to my aid, deliver my soul from the sword, save me, and then I will tell of your name to my brethren, right? So if you deliver me, I will give praise to my brethren. In the midst of the congregation, I will praise you. So that he's offering the Todah sacrifice. I'm going to say that. And then at the end, it says, you who fear the Lord, praise him, in verse 23. So something happened. Something changed. You who fear the Lord, praise him. All you sons of Jacob, glorify him. Stand in awe of him. From you comes my praise in the great congregation. My vows I will pay. The afflicted shall eat and be satisfied. Right? So there's, again, providing the feast. And at the very end, it says, all the families of the nations shall worship before him, for dominion belongs to the Lord. Posterity shall serve him. Men shall tell of the Lord of the coming generation and proclaim his deliverance to a people yet unborn, that he has wrought it. So while it begins in desolation, it ends in praise. Do you think Jesus knew how the psalm ended? Do you think there's a reason why he quoted this psalm from the cross? We'll get back to that. Maybe. Okay. I'm sure we will. So the whole book of Psalms, you'll notice, kind of has this structure also, right? Begins in lament, right? Praise, and then ends with praise, right? So there's kind of that going on. Now, if we look at side note, the Passover meal. The Passover, when they tried to figure out what kind of sacrifice it was, the Jewish rabbis said the Passover was a Todah sacrifice. Why? Because it's not a sin offering, right? It's not a burnt offering. It's saying it's something different. And so they said it's in the category of Thanksgiving offering. Now, this is important because the Jewish rabbis, a second century Jewish rabbi, said this, in the world to come, all sacrifices will be annulled, but the Thanksgiving sacrifice will never be annulled. This is a second century Jewish rabbi, two centuries before Jesus Christ. So they had this idea that somehow in the future, the other offerings would cease, but when the Messiah comes, this one's going to remain for some important reason. We don't know exactly why that is, or they didn't know, but we know. Because Jesus at the Last Supper, he takes the Passover and he transforms it into the new and everlasting Passover. All the other sacrifices cease, but the one thank offering remains. That's why we offer it, because the Todah, the Thanksgiving offering, that's why we call Mass Eucharistia, which in Greek means Thanksgiving. The Mass is the sacrifice of praise. Woohoo! Yes! Sorry, I blew the ending. Okay, I can't help myself. Okay, all right. But then we see Psalm 22. Let's go ahead and look at that. Psalm 22 Jesus is interpreting his whole action on the cross as being a todah sacrifice, meaning that the cross and the Mass are brought in together, right? That's what we believe, right? Is that the Mass is the representation of the once-for-all offering to the Father, right? So the Lord is interpreting what he's doing on the cross. He's not complaining to God that, God, why have you left me on the cross here? Oh, this is terrible. That's what some people think, but they're wrong. They don't know the Bible. Because, see, here's the deal. The Jews did not have numbering system for the Psalms, and that's why it's confusing. In your Bible, you'll notice you'll have brackets next to the Psalm because there are two different numberings for the Psalms depending on whether you're following the Greek Septuagint or the Latin Vulgate. So the fact is that there were different numberings in existence. So how did the Jews know which psalm was which? It was the first line. They would say, turn to you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. That was what they called Psalm 25. It was the first line of the psalm was its name, not Psalm 25. The Lord is my shepherd is the psalm, not Psalm 23, right? Because depending on the numbering, it's either Psalm 22 or Psalm 23, and that's confusing, right? But if you say the Lord is my shepherd, everybody knows what you're talking about, yes? So the fact is that that's how they knew which psalm it was. And so when Jesus is saying, my God, why have you forsaken me? They're immediately playing that whole psalm in their mind. And they're realizing, wow, what is happening right here is Good Friday unfolding before my eyes. Let's go through it and watch. Why are you so far from helping me from the words of my groaning? O God, I cry by day, but you do not answer, and by night, but find no rest. Yet you are holy, enthroned on the praises of Israel. In you our fathers trusted. They trusted and you delivered them. To you they cried and were saved, and you they trusted and were not disappointed. Here we get, but I am a worm and no man, scorned by men, despised by the people. All who see me mock at me. They make mouths at me. They wag their heads. He committed his cause to the Lord. Let him deliver him. Let him rescue him, for he delivers him. Remember, let him come down from the cross if this is the Son of God. Everyone's mocking him, right? The fact is, David never had this experience, right? This is in the first book. This is talking about the sufferings of David. David never had this experience. What are they talking about? It's a prophetic psalm, right? It's like, the only other way we can understand it, it's like hyperbolic. It's kind of weird. But look, it gets even more descriptive. You are he who took me from the womb. You kept me safe in my mother's breast. Upon you I was cast from my birth. Since my mother bore me, you have been my God. Be not far from me. For trouble is near, many bulls encompass me, strong bulls of Bashan surround me, they open their mouths at me like a ravening, roaring lion, I'm poured out like water, and all my bones are out of joint, I thirst, right? Some of the mystics, they speak about how when, and this, you saw this in the Passion, how when they stretched him out on the cross, they dislocated his shoulder. This is not in the scriptures, but this is something that Blessed Catherine Emmerich and Padre Pio and others have spoken about, that the shoulder wound of Christ is one of the more painful wounds that he had, right? Of the cross and then dislocation, right? My heart is like wax, it's melted within my breast. My strength is dried up like a potsherd. My tongue cleaves to my jaws. You lay me in the dust of death. They have pierced my hands and my feet. I can count all my bones, right? Are you kidding me? Like, how much more literal do you need to get? They don't have any experience like this in King David's life. This is all prophetically looking forward. It doesn't make sense until it's actually playing out in front of them, and then they see what it meant. I can count all my bones. They stare and gloat over me. They divide my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots. They took his garment, which was woven from top to bottom, seamless, and they said, let's not tear it, but let's cast lots for it to see whose it shall be. Right? But you, O Lord, be not far off. Deliver my soul from the sword, my life from the power of the dog. Save me from the mouth of the lion. And then it goes into the todah promises, I will praise your name among my brethren, etc. Right? My vows I will pay before those who fear him. The afflicted shall eat and be satisfied. When he offers himself, he said, this is my body. And he feeds them not with somebody else's bread, but with his own flesh. And the poor and the afflicted have food that leads to everlasting life. Woo! The bread that I will give is my flesh for the life of the world. Anyone who eats this bread will live forever. You see, all this stuff is right here. Why aren't you reading the Psalms yet? The Psalms are life. They're our lifeblood. They're so beautiful. And they're the prayer of Jesus. Right? We need to imitate him by praying the Psalms because this is the prayer of Jesus. Right? Now, just as a side note, again, there are four senses of Scripture. So there's the literal sense, which means what it meant in that time. And then we need to know what that is first so that we can have a proper interpretation. This psalm doesn't make any sense in its original context. Because the Jews were very confused by this psalm. They're like, this doesn't make sense. David didn't experience this. We don't know what it means. Right? So then we look at the other three meanings. There's a moral sense. How do you apply that to your life? I don't know. It doesn't really make sense. How do I apply that morally to my life? How do I apply this to my life? I mean, I can pray to God when I'm having really difficult situations, but like it doesn't quite fit. Then you have the allegorical sense, which just is an allegory, meaning how does this relate to Jesus Christ? And here's where it finds its real meaning. And then the last one is called the anagogical sense. That's a fun word. If you learn that's an SAT word, write it down, kids. All right, anagogical. That means how does this psalm relate to the last things, death, judgment, heaven, hell? How does it relate to our ultimate destiny in heaven, right? Well, how does it relate? Well, the ultimate, the last two phrases of it, right? Dominion belongs to the Lord. He rules over the nations. All the ends of the earth will remember and turn to the Lord. All the families of the nations will worship before him. Yes, to him all the proud of the earth will bow down. Before him will bow all who go to the dust and he who cannot keep himself alive. Posterity shall serve him. Men shall tell of the Lord to the coming generation and proclaim his deliverance to a people yet unborn. So that's the mission of the church. Boom. Till the end of time. To proclaim to those yet unborn what God has done in Christ Jesus. That's just one psalm. There are 150 of them. There's no way we can cover all these psalms, right? No way, okay? However, perhaps we'll go really quickly to the beginning so we can get an idea of what the whole book is about and its spiritual fruits, so we can draw things out of it. Okay, the first psalm, which we already kind of read, was about wisdom, right? How do you get wisdom? Well, don't walk with wicked people. Guys, how many of you have friends that don't do good stuff? Okay. If you're hanging around them all the time, you're going to become like them. Hate to tell you that. The fact is we become like our friends. If you want to be virtuous, you need better friends. I mean that. If your friends are losers, ditch them. I'm not even kidding, right? Or call them higher. Right? Because if you can't call them higher, you're going to become like them. Because we're not strong enough, right? The people that you hang around will tend to influence you. Is this true or not? Do you find this to be true? I find it to be very true. Over and over and over again, if you have friends who are stoners, or if you've got friends who are fornicators, you have friends who are addicted to drugs or alcohol, you're going to tend to follow them. It's not likely that they're going to follow you. Now, they do sometimes, right? But the fact of the matter is that the people you spend the most time with, you tend to become like them, unless if you're a really strong person of virtue and character to pull them upward, right? So have good friends around you. And we only have space for about two or three really good friends in our life. One, you said one? Okay, Josh, one. Okay, one good friend. All right, she's sitting next to you, right? Okay, good, all right, yeah, sure. Okay, good. So the fact of the matter is that, friends, if you have one good friend or two or three, you are very blessed. We tend to think if we have 1,000 Facebook friends, we're going to be happy. The fact is, I had like 2,000 Facebook friends, and I lost them all in a second, and it was traumatic for a few months, and I'm okay. I'm alive, right? Because the heart doesn't have capacity for that many people. Yeah, you can always be kind to people and say hi, but the fact is, to have really deep, lasting friendships, you got to pour a lot into those people. So pick them wisely. Make those friends 1 in 1,000, because you'll become like them. So don't walk in the counsel of the wicked, don't stand in the way of sinners or sit in the company of scorners, but delight in the law of the Lord and meditate on his law day and night. Right? How many of you know there's bad music out there? Okay, I'm not going to ask who listens to it, right? But the fact is that we have music that's proposing really terrible ideas all day long, right? Really horrible ideas about relationships, about how we should speak, about how we should dress, how we should behave. It's like, if you're listening to that garbage all day long, you think you're going to start imitating it? Better believe it. We need to meditate on God's law. We need to, the Psalms, if the Psalms are the music of our life, then we're going to tend to be much more virtuous. That's what the design of this was for. So a lot of people, they have iPods in their ears all day long listening to garbage, right? What if you were listening to more sacred music, stuff with better uplifting lyrics, or just even prayers, right? Because that stuff then becomes the meditation of your mind. Highly recommend it. Okay, so the second psalm shows a corollary to this. It's not just important that we don't hang out with sinners. We also need to align ourselves with King David. So this is Psalm 2. Read along with me. Go ahead and open up, guys, if you don't have your Bibles with you. I'm dead serious. You brought your Bibles. Go ahead and bring it up. Open up. If you're not reading along with me, you're wasting your time. Come on. Here we go. Okay. Why do the nations conspire and the peoples plot in vain? The kings of the earth set to themselves and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord and his anointed, saying, let us burst their bonds asunder and cast their cords from us. So that's how the world is, right? The world's trying to get us to abandon God, right? What does it say then? Verse 4, he who sits in the heavens laughs. The Lord has them in derision. Then he will speak to them in his wrath and terrify them in his fury, saying, I have set my king on Zion, my holy mountain. I will tell the decree of the Lord. He said to me, you are my son. Today I have begotten you. This is speaking to King David. God is saying to him directly, you are my son. This day I have begotten you. Ask of me, and I will make the nations your heritage, and the ends of the earth your possession. You will break them with a rod of iron and dash them in pieces like a potter's vessel. Now, therefore, O kings, be wise, be warned, O rulers of the earth. Serve the Lord with fear and with trembling. Rejoice, lest he be angry and you perish in the way, for his wrath is quickly kindled. Blessed are all who take refuge in him. Now, who are we taking refuge in? Here's what's really fascinating. The Hebrew is not really clear here. So it's really beautiful. If you go back up here to verse 11, serve the Lord with fear and with trembling rejoice. That word rejoice is actually not clear. Literally in Hebrew, it says, kiss the son. Isn't that interesting? Or kiss his feet. Trembling, serve the Lord with fear, with trembling, kiss the son, lest he be angry. So who is it that's angry, potentially? The Lord or the son? Interesting. So who are we taking refuge in? The Lord or his son? It's ambiguous because they are the same. It's a prophetic reference, right, to the true son of David, not just King David, but the true royal son of David, Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory and the Son of God, who will come to judge the earth. You better kiss his feet because he's going to be your judge. Make sense, right? Blessed are all those who take refuge in him, not just those who blessed who avoid evil and meditate on the law, but if you're wise, you will align yourself with the Son of David, because that's where God has made the covenant promise, right? It said, I will tell the decree of the Lord in verse 7. It says, actually, I will tell of the covenant of the Lord. Which covenant? The Davidic covenant. Because the covenant that God made with King David is saying, a son will rule on the throne, a fruit of your body forever. Now, it seemed like that was lost in the Babylonian exile, because we don't see a clear heir to the throne. And that's why Matthew's gospel is so electric when it opens up with chapter 1 saying, this is the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. It's like, wait, we thought it was lost. No, we're going to trace the genealogy and show you that as a matter of fact, it wasn't lost in the exile. We still have the line of David, and now it has been handed on through Joseph to Jesus. And most likely through Mary, because you marry the same tribe. So there you go. Ha-ha. Anyway, so these first two psalms are like a double introduction to the whole book, saying this is a book of wisdom, but also a book of King David and his royal son, who we know to be Jesus, right? The Messiah. So look at a couple other psalms. So actually just in relation in this psalm, verse 8, which says, ask of me and I will make the nations your heritage, right? This relates to, remember when we had a couple Sundays ago, the temptation in the desert? What was one of the temptations Satan said? Bow down before me and I will give you all the nations. What a laugh, because he already owns them. He doesn't need to bow to Satan to get them. He will receive them by right when he's crucified and glorified. He will receive them, right? We also say, you are my son. Where do we hear that? In the baptism. It said, this is my beloved son. And then again, in the transfiguration, which we just had also in these readings we're having during Lent, right? This is my beloved son. Listen to him, right? So very clearly, Psalm 2 is showing us as the royal son of David, blessed are those who take refuge in him. We see also in verse 9, it says, you shall break them with a rod of iron. Revelation 12, there's a woman clothed with a son who will give birth to a male child who will rule the nations with an iron rod. So that means Mary's the queen mother. There you go. All right. There you go. Sorry, Protestants. Anyway. Checkmate. No, just kidding. Okay. Anyway. So, all right. Then what else? Oh, there's lots of things, but anyway, we have to move on. Okay. Let's go ahead and we'll go to Psalm 8. We did the Psalm 8 test in the beginning to kind of look at translation, but Psalm 8 is really great because it talks about the Son of Man, right? Psalm 8, if you're reading with me. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You whose glory above the heavens is chanted by the mouths of babes and infants. You have found a bulwark because of your foes to still the enemy and the avenger. When I look at your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars which you have established, what is man that you're mindful of him and the son of man that you care for him? Yet you've made him little less than the angels and have crowned him with glory and honor. You've given dominion over the works of your hands and put all things under his feet. Now this is really remarkable. We've got to stop here and say, what is this talking? Who is this talking about, right? Because this, again, this is in book one, so it's talking about David, right? But we're like, okay, made him little less than the angels? That seems like a bit much, right? Crowned him with glory and honor, yes. Gave him dominion, restoring the rights that Adam had over creation, right? So we see very clearly that's being restored in King David, right? But it's really not complete. It doesn't make quite sense completely because it's just there's a little bit too much, right? He said, all the sheep and the ox and the birds, the beasts of the field, the birds of the air, the fish of the sea, whatever passes along the paths of the sea, O Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. We're going to see this is fully fulfilled in Jesus Christ, where he has dominion over the sea, over the animals, over everything through his miracles. We see that he has dominion over all of creation, makes the storm cease on the waters, right? Makes the miraculous catch of fish. He has control of the fish, right? It's not just I can name the fish, but I can tell them come here and they're going to come. David couldn't do that, okay? I never heard any story about King David saying, here, fishy, fishy, and it just jumped into the boat, right? Right? But Jesus, in fact, did that. Made a miraculous catch of fish. Okay. Good. What else? Yeah, the book of Hebrews talks about for a little while he was made lower than the angels, but now he has received glory and honor and dominion, right? Not lower than the angels because he's always God, but in his human nature for a while before it was glorified, in his humanity, he was less, right? But after the resurrection, it has been glorified above every other creature, right? Okay, so that's Psalm 8, so that's kind of neat. So when Jesus is saying the Son of Man, talking about himself, they could hear that it's just a dude, because that's one of the translations, is what is man that you're mindful of him, or human beings that you care about us, right? You know, that's one of the meanings of it, but ultimately, the full meaning is going to be man and Son of Man. That's what it literally says, and so there's lots of different meanings of it, and it's more fully revealed in Christ. Okay, now we come to, we did Psalm 22 already. So after Psalm 22, which is the crucifixion psalm, you come to Psalm 23, which is the most famous psalm that everybody knows, whether they are Christian or not. You can read that with me. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Now, what's interesting, if you read this in order, you just had the crucifixion, and now we have this. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil. So now it's like the descent into hell, right? Or the descent into the realm of the dead, right? But I'm not afraid, right? Because I know what's going to happen. Then we come to Psalm 24. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. The world and those who dwell therein. He founded it upon the seas and established on the rivers. Who will ascend the mountain of the Lord? Who will stand in the holy place? That song we were singing, right? Right? The clean of hand and pure of heart. Was Jesus clean of hand and pure of heart? The most clean, the most pure of heart. He's the only one worthy. He's the only one holy. There is no one holy but God alone, right? Jesus Christ, he's the pure and holy one. Right? He does not lift up his soul to what's false, does not swear deceitfully. He received blessing from the Lord and vindication from the God of his salvation. So now we have the resurrection. Such is the generation of those who seek him, who seek the face of the God of Jacob. Lift up your heads, O gates. Be lifted up, ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Now he's ascending into heaven and taking the host with him. Who is the King of glory? The Lord, strong and mighty, the Lord, mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, O gates, and be lifted up, O ancient doors, that have been closed since the foundation of sin in the world. Since the sin of Adam, these ancient doors have been closed and now open to receive your Lord. Hallelujah. It's Lent, sorry. Okay. Who is the King of glory? The Lord of hosts, the Lord of armies. He is the King of glory. Woo. Sorry, I get jazzed about this. Because once you read the Psalms as the prayer of Jesus Christ, it changes everything. You're like, wow, this stuff was written 1,000 years at least before Christ came? How is it able to read him like a book? How is it possible that one man can fulfill so many prophecies? This is not just the Psalms. This is all the stuff we've been reading thus far. All the things we've been talking about, friends, these are more than 1,000 years before the coming of Jesus. You can't make a conspiracy like that where all these things come together. It has to be the greatest story that has ever been told. In fact, it's the only story there is. It's the one God has been writing. And we participate in that story to the degree that we become like him. If we don't become like him, we miss the purpose of history, which is his story. Whose story? This guy. It's his story, and we enter into it, and we become part of it, and we are promised to be glorified with him if we're united with him in this life, and in his death, and in his sufferings. Oh, friends, what an amazing adventure. What an amazing life. How can we not share this with everybody else? It's such good news. It's like your whole life is read out here in front of you. Your sorrows, your joys, everything. It's like, I read these things and it's just like, my life too. My life is written on these pages too, and your life is written on these pages too. We ignore this word of God to our peril because we have seen everything before. There is nothing new under the sun except this. This is the only new thing that ever has happened. Everything else, it's repetitive patterns, like on repeat, because we stop, we don't learn. We don't learn from our mistakes. We don't realize that sin is killing us. It is killing all of us. And we've got to stop it by becoming one with him. So we stop the crazy train. It's moving full speed ahead to disaster and death. And we have to get off of it and get on the Jesus train. Amen? Okay. Got to get on it. Okay. We're not even out of book one. How are we going to do this? Okay. All right. Just touching on a couple of important psalms. Just skip ahead with me to... Psalm 41. Psalm 41 is at the end of book one. And again, we just have these really beautiful things right here. This is Psalm 41, verse 7. All who hate me whisper together about me. They imagine the worst for me. So again, this is the end of book one. This is David, right? So that's the original context. But then listen with the ears of the Spirit for what it's looking forward to. They say a deadly thing is fastened upon him. He will not rise again from where he lies. Even my bosom friend in whom I trusted, who ate of my bread, has lifted his heel against me. But you, O Lord, be gracious to me and raise me up that I may repay them. By this I know that you are pleased with me and that my enemy has not triumphed over me. Who was it who ate at the table with him that lifted his heel? Judas, right? The new royal son of David, see? This happened, the original meaning, of course, is Saul. They ate together and Saul tried to pin him to the wall a couple times with a spear, right? But we see very clearly that this is fulfilled in the Lord, who very literally gives the morsel to Satan to Judas directly, and Satan enters into him because his heart is hard and he goes to betray him. But he doesn't have victory over him, only for a time, but it is not victory. All right, lots of great stuff in book two. So if you want to just circle this psalm, really great, Psalm 51. Psalm 51 is the great psalm of mercy, asking God for forgiveness. This psalm is the Lenten psalm, like asking God to forgive us of our sins. This is the psalm that David wrote after being caught with Bathsheba and after Nathan exposed him. It even says that a psalm of David when Nathan the prophet came to him after he had gone into Bathsheba. So after his sin has been exposed, this is the psalm of King David repenting for his sins. It's beautiful, right? Create a clean heart in me, O God, and put a new and right spirit within me. Cast me not away from your presence, and take not your Holy Spirit from me. Right? Because David had received the Holy Spirit, he'd received this grace, and now he's blown it. He's like, God, please don't take away the gift that you gave me, right? Because I deserve it. I deserve to lose everything, but please have mercy and give me a new heart, right? O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth will declare your praise, right? That's what every religious says at the beginning of their day when they're praying. It's the first prayer they pray. Okay. There's way much more we could do. I highly recommend that you get this book, Psalm Basics for Catholics. It will walk through all this stuff. What I want to shift to now in the last couple minutes that we have is about praying with the Psalms. Okay. There's lots of different ways to pray with the Psalms, but the principal way the church does it is in the Mass, as I mentioned, the responsorial psalm. But the other way is through what's called the Liturgy of the Hours, or the breviary. How many of you have heard of Liturgy of the Hours? Anybody? Okay, a few, all right. The Liturgy of the Hours is the psalms for religious and priests. It used to just be in Latin, and it would only be for the priests and religious, but they have translated it now into every language. And if you want to download the app, it is called iBreviary. Okay? It is free, and you can pray it in any language that you'd like, even Farsi, I think. Okay. So they have a lot of different apps, or if you want to buy the actual book, it comes in a one-volume version, or if you like to really go deep, it has a four-volume version, right? Very nice, yes, lovely, there it is. Okay. So if you pray the Liturgy of the Hours, and you pray the five times in the day that it would have, you would pray all 150 psalms in 4 weeks, okay? That's basically five psalms a day. So if you buy the book or not, if you want to keep a good habit of prayer with the psalms, if you prayed five psalms a day, you would rotate through the psalms every month. That's a nice practice. The old breviary, which I've been praying now for about a year just because I wanted to try it out and see what it was, is all 150 psalms in a week, right? So that was what priests used to pray before 1968, right? So before they did the reforms of the breviary, okay? But both of those are very acceptable. They're really great. And you're going to find it's really lovely. There's also a great website called singthehours.org. I just found this today. It's a guy who just sings, chants the Liturgy of the Hours for morning prayer and evening prayer. It's really lovely. It's kind of some modern stuff, but it's also some traditional Gregorian chant melodies. It's really lovely. So if you want to check that out, if you're like, you're not really interested in reading, but you'd like to listen to it sung, because that's how it's designed to be done, that's an option. There are other monasteries who have their stuff on YouTube, which you can find, I'm sure, but these were just a couple options. Also, a great way to do it is read the responsorial psalm for that day's Mass. So that's easily available online. If you look up the daily Mass readings, if you Google daily Mass readings, you can read the responsorial psalm, and that's a great way to pray with the church and get prepared for the Mass of that day. Okay, so those are some great ways to pray. You can also pray some psalms depending on what mood you're in, right? Because there is literally every single emotion contained in the psalms. So these were some recommendations from St. Athanasius that you can find in this book. But if you Google St. Athanasius's recommendations for the Psalms, you might be able to find some of that. Like if you're happy, there's some recommendations for some Psalms. If you're happy, if you're sad, some things, you know, they're there. If you're scared, you're sick, you're tired, you're angry, etc. There's prayers for every emotion. I think this is important for us to realize. God doesn't want you to put on a face when you're praying. He wants you to be who you are, but he wants to draw you higher from where you are. He doesn't leave you there, but it's saying, look, he's going to meet you there. It's okay to be angry with God sometimes. It's okay to be sad. It's okay to be afraid, right? But we don't want to stay in those places. We need to give that to God, and the Psalms give us a language to do that. So if you feel like, I don't know how to pray, the Psalms will give you the language of prayer. It will teach you how to pray when you are frustrated, or when you are anxious, or when you are alone. So this is a great treasure. It will grow with you your whole life. All right. There's lots of other ways you can pray. How many of you listen to Christian music on the radio? Okay. If you're listening to Christian music on the radio, a lot of it is based on the Psalms. Some of it not, a lot of it is. I find it's helpful in certain situations to pray. That's why we do praise and worship music sometimes with adoration. But you'll notice we don't do it during Mass, and there's a reason for this. The reason is that contemporary praise and worship music is designed to excite us. It's designed to get our blood moving. It's designed to get us excited or worked up, if you will. And that can be helpful, but it can also be distracting. So the fact is, when we're in adoration, it's important that we stir our hearts to love God, because it's a time of prayer to love him, to adore him, to praise him. It's very good. We should do that. But we also need quiet time to receive from him, right? So it has its place, right? But if we only use that and we don't have any quiet time, that's dysfunctional, right? We need to have quiet time to listen to him. So anytime we're using praise and worship music, we want to lead to a place of quiet at the end. It's kind of like, it's like lovers, right? You know, you build up crescendo, and then rest in each other's arms, right? And that's the idea with God as well, right? We build. And if you listen to any of the great saints and you read their writings, they go into ecstasy and they have these great unions with God, but then they just rest in his peace, right? So it's important we realize that peace, heaven's going to be incredibly peaceful, right? It's going to be in the presence of love, and we're just going to be in his presence forever. So in the Mass, it's much more contemplative. So chant it's designed differently. Chant is not like da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da, which just gets us really excited, like, okay, I want to jump, I want to march, I want to do this. Chant flows like water. It just kind of flows over us, and it's designed. So if you have anxiety, if you get worked up really easily, chant will lower your heart rate, and it'll calm you down. So if any of you have OCD, or if any of you have anxiety, or if any of you have ADHD, chant will help tremendously. Just pro tip, right? It's designed to integrate us, right? And some of these chant melodies, they go back a couple thousand years. So Gregorian chant, if you're looking for something to really bring some peace into your life, just get some Gregorian chant CDs, and they're going to help you tremendously in that. Okay, good. That's all we can cover today, because we're just about at time. Tonight, we're going to do something different. For those who have RCIA, they can go, but I'll give you an instruction first before we do that. When we come back together, we will chant night prayer together. So we're going to do just a short night prayer, and we're going to give it a try, see how it works, okay? All right? It'll be simple. It won't be complicated. Don't worry. We'll just kind of do basic stuff, and I'll coach you through it, so you have to worry about that. For folks who are staying in here, for the youth, and for los en español que quiere quedarse aquí, si no tiene grupos, puede quedarse aquí. Vamos a tener adoración, y vamos a cantar un poquito, y tener poquito tiempo de silencio. So RCIA, you guys can go to your group, and then come back, be with us for a little bit. And others can go to their groups, or we can stay here. For those who are staying here, the youth and young adults, and we'll have a time of adoration leading into night prayer. Questions are, do you use music as part of your prayer? Have you prayed with the Psalms before? How they help your life of prayer? So maybe talk about your prayer life in small groups and see how you can improve on it. Very good. Go. Discuss it. Okay. Help me flip it. Help me move this. Could you help me to move? Yeah. Just want to take it over there. Yeah. So for our middle and high school, if you guys want to come up and pray yourself, we're going to just get in a place where we can pray easier, so you can kind of come on up here, and we'll get ready for adoration. So we'll go ahead and move up. Everybody got those night prayer ones? Okay, sweet. Let me see. So, how many of you guys got these when you came in? You got these little booklets, programs? Okay. No? Okay. All right. Did we get any more? Well, kind of, if you don't have one, Lupe, do we have additional ones of these for the night prayer in the back? Okay. All right. So what we'll do is we'll share, okay? So if you don't have one, share with your neighbor. What we're going to do is we're going to go through this really quickly. I'm going to teach you how it works. So when we do it together, it's not a mystery to you, okay? Sound good? Okay. So go ahead and, if you don't have one, share off a neighbor who has one, okay? All right, just bring them up. I'll show you how it works, okay? So basically, it's got little directions in the red text there, like make the sign of the cross. So that's how you begin, make the sign of the cross. And anytime it's got a little dash right there, that's you guys' response. So I would do the first part and then the little red dash. I'd say, God, come to my assistance. And you respond, Lord, make haste to help me, all right? So God, come to my assistance. All right, guys, come on, you gotta help me out here. God, come to my assistance. Perfect. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Okay. And so then we'll have an examination of conscience. We'll pray the I confess to Almighty God. We pray that together, okay, like at Mass. All right. And then there's a hymn, which is just a very simple melody. Oh, goodness. No, it isn't. Why did they do that to us? That is not okay. Why did they do that? That is silly. Why did they give us that hymn? That is terrible. Okay, I'm glad we looked through this. We're going to use a different hymn. So we're going to take it from our songbooks. Okay, so you get our songbook. Okay, so we're going to do number 247. So you can put the yellow ribbon on 247 in the English book. Okay, so go ahead and grab an English book and put it in song number 247. So prepare the books that are in front of you. That way when people come in later, they can find it really quickly. Okay, so you guys can use those ones up here. Yep, good. Okay, boom. Yep, okay, good. Everybody else is going to be so impressed because we're all going to be all ready to do this. Okay, good. Okay, now the way that we pray psalms in this way is side by side, or it's called antiphonally. So one side does one paragraph, the other side does another paragraph. So anytime you have a line break, it switches sides. Does that make sense? Okay, so I'll give you an example, okay? So we'll be on this side. Preserve me, God, I take refuge in you. I say to the Lord, you are my God. My happiness lies in you alone. And now you guys will go. He has put into my heart. Are you reading along? Okay, got it. You got a program. Okay, who has programs? You guys have a program? Follow along, people. Come on. Just in this one. Yeah, that's, yeah, 247. 247. Yeah, in the back. Yeah. All right, so you guys following along in here? You got it? Okay, all right. So the way it's marked out here, anytime you see that little cross at the end of the line, so you see that at the end of the first line, preserve me, God, I take refuge in you, it's got a little cross at the end of it, you see that? That's a sign that it goes down. So it'll be like, preserve me, God, I take refuge in you. That makes sense? Anytime a cross, it's like pointing down, so you go, da-da-da-da, like that, okay? Does that make sense? You guys follow along there? Okay, good. All right, so normally the way it would go is, I'll just chant it out so you can hear it. Preserve me, God, I take refuge in you. I say to the Lord, you are my God. My happiness lies in you alone. Isn't that fun? Yeah. You has put into my heart a marvelous love for the faithful ones who dwell in his land. Those who choose other gods increase their sorrows. Never will I offer their offerings of blood. Never will I take their name upon my lips. Make sense? So you see those little marks that are there? That shows you kind of where the shift happens in the music. Does that make sense? Okay. It's the first time ever doing it. So why don't we all just sing it together with me? That way you're hearing the whole thing. Okay, so let's try that. It's from the beginning. Preserve me, God. I take refuge in you. I say to the Lord, you are my God. My happiness lies in you alone. He has put into my heart a marvelous love for the faithful ones who dwell in his land. Those who choose other gods increase their sorrows. Never will I offer their offerings of blood. Never will I take their name upon my lips. O Lord, it is you who are my portion and cup. It is you yourself who are my prize. The lot marked out for me is my delight. Welcome indeed the heritage that falls to me. I will bless the Lord who gives me counsel, who even at night directs my heart. I keep the Lord ever in my sight. Since he is at my right hand, I shall stand firm. And so my heart rejoices, my soul is glad. See, this is, they keep doing it wrong. I'm sorry for that. This is a lot more complicated than I imagined. But you guys are doing great, considering that you've never seen this before. And I haven't either. Okay. And so my heart rejoices, my soul is glad. Even my body shall rest in safety. For you will not leave my soul among the dead, nor let your beloved know decay. You will show me the path of life, the fullness of joy in your presence. At your right hand, happiness forever. Glory to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. In you, my God, my body rests in hope. So even if you weren't able to sing along with that, do you kind of get the idea of just kind of, you feel that, kind of how it's a wave and just kind of keeps moving, right? If you can't sing along with it, it's okay. Just receive it and listen to it for the first time, okay? Because that's part of the process, is that we're listening and we're singing along to the place that we can, but entering into the prayer, okay? Then we have a reading, just like at Mass, and then a short responsorial psalm. So that's, into your hands, Lord. Into your hands, Lord, I commend my spirit. Into your hands, Lord, I commend my spirit. You have redeemed us, Lord God of truth. I commend my spirit. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Into your hands, Lord, I commend my spirit. And then we all stand together, and we do what's called the gospel canticle, okay? So this is from Luke's gospel, and this is what Zechariah says when John the Baptist this is what Simeon says when he sees Jesus when he's brought to the temple. Now, Lord, you can let your servant go in peace. It's a beautiful prayer to say at the end of the day, because if we don't wake up in the morning, we pray that we would be protected and brought home, right? So it's a last prayer that we pray, because we never know when it's our time to go, right? So we say, because I've seen the Lord today, because I lived in peace with him, I'm ready to go home if tonight's the last night, right? Make sense? So we'll go ahead and we'll stand, okay? The antiphon I say first by myself at the end, we'll all say the antiphon together. Protect us, Lord, as we stay awake. Watch over us as we sleep, that awake we may keep watch with Christ, and asleep rest in his peace. And then we make the sign of the cross, and we all sing this together, okay? Lord, now you let your servant go in peace. Your word has been fulfilled. My own eyes have seen the salvation which you have prepared in the sight of every people, a light to reveal you to the nations, and the glory of your people Israel. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Protect us, Lord, as we stay awake. Watch over us as we sleep, that awake we may keep watch with Christ, and asleep rest in his peace. And then we have a concluding prayer, just like at Mass, and then the sign of the cross, and then we conclude with a Marian hymn, okay? And the Marian hymn we sing is the one we pray during Mass, the Ave Regina Calorum, okay? So if you want to follow along with that one, that's also in your book. That's where the blue ribbon typically goes. So the Ave Regina Calorum is on page what? Who has that number? If the books are set up right, then they should be set up so that they're there, but it looks like some people have played around with the ribbon, so that's not the case. Okay. Ave Regina Calorum is number 58. So if you want to set your blue ribbon on 58 and the yellow ribbon on 247, then you'll be ready for both of those hymns. Okay? Sound good? Okay. Think you guys got it? It's the first time for it, right? So it's a different kind of prayer. So if you've never been exposed to that kind of prayer before, we'll try it together. Okay? All right. We're going to impress the socks off the parents. How about that? Okay, good. We're going to go ahead and we're going to take some time with adoration. Keep these books with you and make sure that they're ready. And that way, at the end of our time of adoration, we'll do night prayer as our way to close the night. Sound good? Okay. Before we get to start with adoration, you guys can sit for a second. Okay. Did anybody have any questions that they wanted to ask or any thing they wanted to share from last healing night of any graces that people had for St. Joseph? maybe so? No? Okay. All right. Then we'll go ahead and we'll get prepared for adoration. So as we've mentioned before, adoration is a time of prayer. It's for you. So don't worry about what your friends are doing. Okay, this is time for you. If you're distracted by your friends, then come up forward and just spend time with Jesus so that you can enter into that time of prayer, because we don't get to pray very much, right? We don't have a lot of prayer time that's just for us. So if you can take that time with him, just get in a place that's comfortable for you where you can see. You can come up here closer if you want to kneel, if you want to be seated, that's fine. But have a disposition of prayer, and at the very least, don't distract your neighbor, okay? All right, it's important that we take this time to be with the Lord, because he has something great for each and every one of us whenever we come to pray, okay? And if you have difficulties or problems or trials, give them to him, right? We'll leave the lights on low so you can still see. If you'd like to read any of the Psalms while we're praying, that's a beautiful thing you can do. If you're wondering, what do I do during adoration? Pray through some of the Psalms, okay? And use those as your prayer to God, right? Okay. And just so you know, friends, the prayers that we sing at the beginning, at the end of adoration, you can find on the inside back cover of your pew missals. So all the words are on there if you want to follow along with those words.
O salutaris hostia, qui celi pandis hostium, bella premunt hostilia, darober fer auxilium, unitrinoque domino, sit sempiterna gloria, qui vitam sine termino, nobis donet in patria. Amen.
Lord God, we ask as we enter into this time of adoration, of song, of prayer, and of quiet, that you would fill our hearts with holy desire for you. Help us to see you, to love you, and to know you as you are, and receive your grace. Blessed Mother, we give you this time. St. Joseph, we give you this time. We ask that you pray for us and make it fruitful. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Dios te salve, Maria. Llena eres de gracia, Señor es contigo. Bendita tú eres entre todas las mujeres, y bendito es el fruto de tu vientre, Jesús. Santa Maria, Madre de Dios, prega por nosotros, otros pecadores, ahora y en hora de nuestra muerte. Amen.
You can come up and you can come closer to him if you like at any time.
Spirit. Come, great fire of God, enkindle in us the fire of your love. Transform us that we may become the image of God's only Son.
Come, Holy Spirit.
Come, Holy Spirit.
Come, great fire of God.
Come, great fire of God.
Enkindle in us the fire of your love.
Enkindle in us the fire of your love.
Transform us that we may become.
Transform us that we may become
the image.
The image of God's only Son. Come, Holy Spirit. Come, great fire of God. Enkindle in us the fire of your love.
Transform us.
Transform us that we may become the image of God's only Son.
Make us holy.
Make us holy, holy as you are holy. Make us transform us that we may become the image of God's only Son.
Jesus, we want to be one with you. Send your Holy Spirit and help us. Lord, we can't do it on our own. We don't have clean hands or pure hearts without your help. Purify us. Make us holy, Jesus. Send your Holy Spirit, your holy divine fire. As you send it upon the apostles at Pentecost, send it upon us so we would have holy joy, that we would not be afraid, that we would not be filled with anxiety or worries. You are Lord of all. You are Lord of life and death. You are Lord of our families, of our world, of our parish. We entrust everything to you, Lord. Lord, we need you and we ask for your grace.
Lord, I need you. My righteousness, O God, how I need you. Te necesito, cada hora, oh Dios, mi defensor, mi salvador, Señor, te necesito. Sin runs deep, your grace is more. Where grace is found is where you are. And where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need steadfastness. O God, how I need you.
Lord Jesus, my resources are very limited. I need you. I need you in the morning. I need you in the morning to get up. I need you throughout the day to stay faithful. I need you to have rest. If the Lord does not build the house, in vain do the builders labor. If the Lord does not watch over the city, in vain does the watchman keep vigil. You are the God who works wonders.
Eres Dios eterno, solo tú eres bueno, Dios incomparable, eres tú. Nunca me separaré de tu gran amor, eres mi Señor, mi Salvador. Eres Dios eterno, solo tú eres bueno, Dios incomparable, eres tú. Nunca me separaré de tu gran amor, eres mi Señor, mi Salvador. Oh, su dolorosa pasión, de misericordia de nosotros y del mundo entero. Por su dolorosa pasión, de misericordia de nosotros y del mundo entero. Por su dolorosa pasión, ten misericordia de nosotros y del mundo entero. For the sake of his sorrowful passion, have mercy on us and on the whole world.
Lord, we're sinful in need of your grace. Lord, we have failed in our plan to follow you, Lord Jesus. And we need your grace to get back on the right track. Have mercy on us. Have mercy on those who don't love you. Have mercy on those who don't even think of you. Lord, as we pray, Lord, have mercy on those who never, ever think of you and don't want a relationship with you. Lord, may they not be lost. Have mercy on them.
Por su dolorosa pasión, ten misericordia de nosotros y del mundo entero. Por su dolorosa pasión, ten misericordia de nosotros y del mundo entero. Padre eterno, te ofrezco el cuerpo y la sangre, el alma y la divinidad de tu amadísimo Hijo, nuestro Señor, Jesucristo, como propiciación de nuestros pecados y los del mundo entero.
Jesus, have mercy. Offer to you, Lord, all of my friends, offer to you all my family, all of those who have turned their backs on you. I ask you, Lord, that you have mercy on them. You'd reach out with your healing love to each one of them where they are right now. Lord, I ask that you reach out to the soul here who's most in need of your mercy, who's most been crying out to you in the darkness, asking, where are you, God? The one who's most been in need of your touch and your mercy. Jesus, I ask that you pour out your grace right now as we pray, that they would not be alone, that they would not feel alone any longer. Jesus, show your goodness to them.
Holy Spirit, come, great fire of God, enkindle in us the fire of your love. Transform us that we may become the image of God's only Son. All who are thirsty, all who are weak, come to the fountain. Dip your heart in the streams of life. Let the pain and the sorrow be washed away. Of his mercy, as deep cries out to deep, we sing, come, Lord Jesus, come.
Come, Lord Jesus.
We sing, come, Lord Jesus, come.
You're already here, Lord. Ask, Lord, that you would come into our hearts. You're already on the altar. Come into our hearts, Jesus, and make your home in us. If you're thirsty for him, if you want to know the living water, if you want to know his love that knows no end, that can't be taken away by anyone, that can't be stomped on by betrayal, that can't be gotten rid of by illness or disease or suffering, ask him, come, Lord Jesus, I want to know you.
All who are thirsty, all who are weak, come to the fountain. Dip your heart in the streams of life. Let the pain and the sorrow be washed away. Of his mercy, as deep calls out to deep, we sing, come, Lord Jesus, come. Come, Lord Jesus, come. As deep cries out to cries out to deep, as deep cries out to deep, we sing, come, Lord Jesus, come.
All who are thirsty,
all who are thirsty, all who are weak,
come to the fountain.
Come to the fountain, dip your heart in the stream of life. Let the pain and the sorrow be washed away in the waves of his mercy. As deep cries out to deep, we sing, come, Lord Jesus, come. We sing, come, Lord Jesus, come.
Open my understanding. Open my eyes to see you. Friends, as we prepare to pray night prayer together, the hymn in here is not, I don't know it, so we're going to use the hymn in the books, number 247 in the English books, number 247. And then at the end of night prayer, we will use the Marian hymn, Ave Regina Chelorum, which is number 96 in the English books. If you don't have one of these programs, that's okay. You can either read off of your neighbor, or you can just let it wash over you and just receive the prayer of the church. This is being prayed all over the world by priests and religious right now in different places throughout the world. And so we're entering into that prayer of Jesus for his church as she gets ready for bed. The church never sleeps. The church is always awake because the church is the body of Christ. We pray for protection for all of her members who are going to sleep soon. And for those who won't wake up, for those whom this is their last night on earth, we pray for them too, that they be ready to go home. That's the purpose of night prayer, that if this is our last night on earth, that we go home in peace with God. So receive tonight's peace as we pray in the presence of our Lord. We'll do our best to chant it. They didn't do a great job of putting the marks here, so we'll do our best. And normally we go side to side, one side and the other, but we'll just do it together tonight for simplicity's sake. And you can follow me to the best of your ability, okay? Or as I said, just receive it. But the monks teach when we're praying, it's good to at least vocalize it. Even if you're not singing it, it's good to breathe the words as you're praying it, because there's something that changes when you say the words out loud. It's different praying it in your mind versus speaking it out loud. It has power when you speak the word of God out loud. So even if you're not singing it, breathe it, speak it. Okay? You'll notice a difference. So we'll begin standing, and then we'll either kneel or be seated during the psalm, okay? God, come to my assistance. Lord, make haste to help me. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. We take a moment now to examine our conscience, to be reminded of any place of sin, so that we would repent of it now interiorly in our hearts. En este momento vamos a tener un momento de silencio examinando nuestra conciencia para que podamos entender nuestros pecados y pedir la misericordia del Señor. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do, through my fault, through my fault, through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Amen. We'll go to number 247.
Soul of my Savior, sanctify my breast. Body of Christ, be thou my saving guest. Blood of my Savior, bathe me in thy tide. Wash me with water flowing from his side. Strength and protection may thy passion be. O blessed Jesus, hear and answer me. Deep in thy wounds, Lord, hide and shelter me. So shall I never, never part from thee.
Guard and defend me from the foe malign. In death's drear moments, make me only thine. Call me and bid me come to thee on high, where I may praise thee with thy saints for aye.
Can you be seated? In you, my God, my body will rest in hope. Preserve me, God, I take refuge in you. I say to the Lord, you are my God. My happiness lies in you alone. He has put into my heart a marvelous love for the faithful ones who dwell in his land. Those who choose other gods increase their sorrows. Never will I offer their offerings of blood. Never will I take their name upon my lips. O Lord, it is you who are my portion and cup. It is you yourself who are my prize. The lot marked out for me is my delight. Welcome indeed the heritage that falls to me. I will bless the Lord who gives me counsel, who even at night directs my heart. I keep the Lord ever in my sight. Since he is at my right hand, I shall stand firm. And so my heart rejoices, my soul is glad. Even my body shall rest in safety. For you will not leave my soul among the dead, nor let your beloved know decay. You will show me the path of life, the fullness of joy in your presence. At your right hand, happiness forever. Glory to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit. As it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. In you, my God, my body will rest in hope. May the God of peace make you perfect in holiness. May he preserve you whole and entire, spirit, soul, and body, irreproachable at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Into your hands, Lord, I commend my spirit. Into your hands, Lord, I commend my spirit. You have redeemed us, Lord God of truth. I commend my spirit. Glory to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit. Into your hands, Lord, I commend my spirit.
We'll all stand together.
Protect us, Lord, as we stay awake. Watch over us as we sleep, that awake we may keep watch with Christ, and asleep rest in his peace.
We make the sign of the cross, we pray together.
Lord, now you let your servant go in peace. Your word has been fulfilled. My own eyes have seen the salvation, which you have prepared in the sight of every people. A light to reveal you to the nations and the glory of your people Israel. Glory to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Protect us, Lord, as we stay awake. Watch over us as we sleep, that awake we may keep watch with Christ, and asleep rest in his peace. Let us pray.
Lord God, send peaceful sleep to refresh our tired bodies. May your help always renew us and keep us strong in your service. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
May the all-powerful Lord grant us a restful night and a peaceful death. Amen.
Ave Regina Chilorum, 96.
Ave Regina Chelorum, Ave Domina Angelorum, Salve Radix, Salve Porta, Ex qua mundo lux est orta, Gaude Virgo Gloriosa, Super omnes speciosa, Vale o Vale decora, Et pro nobis Christum exora.
After night prayer in the monasteries, they have grand silence until the morning. So I encourage you to keep an atmosphere of prayer and quiet on your way homes so you can take this peace home with you to your bed with you. The homework for next week will be chapter 6 in the Bible Basics book and all the Bible verses that they talk about in chapter 6. So you should be up to chapter 6 in the Bible Basics for Catholics book in the Biblia paso a paso, capítulo 6, por la próxima semana. Buenas noches, hermanos, y vamos a mantener oración y paz aquí.